Welcome to the Big E Outdoor Radio Show with your hosts, Big E and Brandon of Big E TV. Found nationally on your favorite outdoor television channels. Big E Outdoor Radio challenges all the hot topics in the outdoors, from racing to hunting and even grilling in the backyard. Our mission is to educate on the facts of the impact of the outdoors on all our lives and encourage good stewardship and good fellowship among our ranks. Follow Big E Outdoors on Facebook at Big E Outdoors and Big E Outdoor Radio. Send us feedback and get in on conversations with us. Fasten your seatbelts, because this ain't your daddy's morning show. We'll be right back with Big E and Brandon in the morning on Big E Outdoor Radio. Big E Outdoors, located at Cedar Creek, is reopening its doors soon after its new remodeling. Home to the area's first and only big game hunting museum, with educational exhibits displaying animals from around the world and facts around the hunters' contributions to their survival. Pick up some unique souvenirs and gifts from the museum and from the Big E TV shows. Meet the pro staff from Big E TV and Big E Outdoor Radio. A great place to stop in with the whole family. And while you're there, book your next hunting trip with the Big E Outdoors Professional Hunters. With over 21 personal hunting destinations worldwide, you'll be sure to find a quality getaway with the Big E Outdoors destinations. Big E Outdoors is also home to Adrenaline High Geographic. Check us out online at BigEOutfitters.com and register to win a free hunt. Big E Outdoors at Cedar Creek. Well, good morning here, and welcome to another episode of Big E Outdoors. And this morning, I am going it alone because my co-host, Brandon, is off on his honeymoon. Brandon is married now, as we all probably have known and have heard. And so he is joining the ranks of those of us who are inevitably and forever wrong. He's a married man now, so... good luck to Brandon. He's off someplace in the Bahamas, and he went on a cruise, which is, I guess, probably the most favorite way of a woman to get rid of her husband. I guess you throw him off the ship, so let's hope that Brandon actually returns. We'll see how things are going. I haven't heard from him since he got on the ship, so all we can do is hope that everything's going well. I sure hope that I hear from you again there, Brandon. So anyway, today in outdoor news on Big E Outdoor Radio, we've got a lot of great topics to talk about, from wolf attacks to the wolf population, night hunting for the Native American tribes in Wisconsin, and a lot of other things. Even Dr. Walter Palmer, he has been vindicated and showing that he was perfectly legal in his lion hunt. We'll get into that too. So let's get right with it this morning. Talking about the wolf attack, there was one down in the Friendship area, the Adams County area, the Colburn Wildlife area. We got a fella down there, and he claimed that he was attacked by three wolves, which is very rare, supposedly, that wolves attack people. He was out scouting, I guess. It was too warm to hunt, so he was out scouting in that Colburn area. And I've actually hunted that area myself, so I can tell you it's a big area, and it's a great spot for deer hunting. And evidently, he was carrying a .38 on his side, and supposedly he was came upon three wolves, two that were on his side and one that was supposedly off in his front that he had run into, and they came after him. But according to the DNR article that I read, or the report, there was no torn clothing, and there was no evidence to suggest that he was physically attacked by the wolves or anything like that. So he had no bites, no injuries, nothing like that. So that is the kind of stuff that actually is going to give him some difficulty in the investigation, because one of the wolves he actually shot. They didn't find the body of the wolf because he went back and took the DNR back to search for this wolf. And they did find blood, but the blood trail did stop a little bit into the brush somewhere, and they didn't find the wolf. So thankfully the game wardens are not good trackers, which that doesn't surprise me either. But you know, first of all, I don't understand why the guy would go ahead and call the thing in and even call the DNR and tell them about this, because you know that you just shot an endangered species, and if you're not attacked yourself or not torn up, you know how the DNR works. And I don't know whether you want to chalk this up to the fact that that's just the way that they have to work, or it's their job, or what have you. But when you're dealing with the Department of Natural Resources, it seems like even if you're did things mostly right in this case, you know that you're likely going to come out of this thing with a ticket. And, you know, you could face jail time for shooting an endangered species like that. So, I mean, you pretty much just called them up and admitted that you did something wrong. Which would tell a lot of folks that he probably didn't do anything wrong. Those of us that have common sense, but, you know, again, we're not dealing with folks that have a lot of common sense here, it seems, because they seem to make a lot of decisions that a lot of us hunters don't agree with. So he kind of opened up a can of worms for himself now. I don't know how a lot of you folks feel about that. I guess, you know, you can weigh in on our Facebook page. We get a lot of comments on a lot of different things in our message column there. And, I kind of feel for the guy. I know where the predicament that he's in right now, because he's guilty until proven innocent. That seems to be the way things work here in Wisconsin. But the other hand, I also look at it and there's never been this would be the first wolf attack actually in the state of Wisconsin, obviously, on a person, because we don't have a long history with wolves here. And there just haven't been a lot of wolf attacks on people overall around the United States. But it just sounds a little bit unbelievable when you listen to the account of the attack and how they came at him. And it almost sounds like he may have over-panicked when he came upon a wolf, seen it, and just shot it. And then had to come up with, you know, a reason for what he had done. I'm not sure. So I guess the DNR's investigation is going to prove it and come up with, you know, an answer to it all. And the only account that they have and the only evidence that they have, I guess, is this guy's story to go on. So, you know, I guess if it holds up, they're just going to have to go along with what he says. So, you know, a wolf attack is very rare, like I said. Never been one in the state of Wisconsin. The facts are that he didn't have any, you know, not even any ripped clothing. No sign that they actually physically attacked him. They just were there. Now the DNR is saying that he could have stumbled into what the wolves call a gathering place, or what they call a wolf gathering place, where they gather to meet their young or whatever. Or he could have stumbled onto a spot where they had a kill nearby, or even a hunter's bear bait site that they were trying to protect or something like that. So, you know, on the hunter side of things, I guess those are possibilities. So it's kind of a touchy subject, but, you know, it gets into our debate over this entire wolf population as it is. And We are just getting into the time of the year now when we would have a wolf season, but we don't this year. And obviously, the wolves are on the increase in population, regardless of whether we'd had a season or not. But now, there is no season. So the wolf population is going to rise. And by next year, I believe that we are going to start seeing a lot of problems with wolves. By the time we come back and get into our next segment here with Biggie Outdoors, I'll tell you some of the problems that we've already encountered in 2015 that are on the rise from 2014. And this is just with the population being the way it would have been if we were to have a season this year. This goes up to October 2nd, and our wolf season would have started October 15th. So now let's add in all the wolves that would have been hunted and increase the population not only by those wolves, but by the offspring of those wolves. And that's going to raise the wolf population considerably for next year. And then let's do it again for the following year, because all of those wolves and their offspring and the ones that would have been killed the following year, you see how this multiplication starts going. You know, 5 times 5 times 5 times 5 plus their offspring. This thing starts to grow really fast. And you know, and 5 isn't really the number. We're talking, you know, 50, 75, whatever the wolf quota would have been. So we are definitely going to end up with a serious wolf problem here, endangered or not. And this wasn't a decision that was made by the DNR. So on this particular topic, this is one of the things where we can't give the DNR a lot of grief on it. But we also have to remember that the DNR created the problem because they're the ones that brought the wolves into the state of Wisconsin. So we will, this is one of them deals that we didn't want the wolves here, but the DNR decided, let's bring these wolves in, dump them into the state of Wisconsin. And now we have a problem because a federal judge turned around and put them on the endangered list. And we're stuck with the problem, a multiplying problem that we're going to have to deal with for years to come. And now there's nothing we can do about it. So we'll get into some of the new increases in numbers and the increased problems just in a moment. We'll be right back with some more Biggie Outdoor Radio. Hey, welcome back to Biggie Outdoor Radio. And because Brandon is off on his, I got to have somebody else help me host my radio show here. So I've got the other Biggie in here with me.
The real Biggie.
Well, he's kind of a littler Biggie version.
I don't, can't really say that. I'm bigger than you.
What are you talking about? You're way shorter than I am.
Well, you might be shorter, but I'm bigger than you.
Oh, is that how it is? Oh, okay. You're not as big as Willie up there, that's for sure.
Oh, no, that's Sasquatch.
Because we're in our mobile studio, you got to talk up. Good, and you got to talk toward the middle here, as far as the microphone is. So, just so you know.
Okay.
So I was just talking in here about our wolves in Wisconsin, but before I get into that, Ernie is actually with me. We're actually doing some deer hunting in Wisconsin this week. He brought up a friend from Alabama and came up here to enjoy this great Indian summer that we're getting. The weather's pretty decent, isn't it?
It is.
Better than the last time you were up here in Wisconsin.
Absolutely. I can feel my fingers this time.
Ernie's from southern Alabama, down in Montgomery, Alabama, and he actually came up and has hunted with us before, although the last time that he was up here it was like 21 degrees below zero or something like that. A little colder than what he's used to down there, but we're doing some whitetail hunting up at the Three Lakes Trophy Ranch in Three Lakes, Wisconsin. And we have Willie Adams is up here hunting with us. And this is the first time that I think he's been to Wisconsin hunting. Or anyway, the first time he's been up here hunting with us. So we've been seeing some pretty good bucks while we're out here. So if anybody's looking for a good place to hunt, this is definitely one of the great places that we offer. And Ernie's also on our Big E Pro staff too, so you know, he's called in. You've called into the radio show before, haven't you?
That's correct.
So you were on your way somewhere, weren't you? I don't know, were you on your way to Dallas or something?
Correct. I was in Dallas, Texas on some training.
So is there, while you're here, maybe we can get you on a deer, but time's running short, isn't it?
It is. Three Lakes Plantation.
Three Lakes Trophy Ranch.
Three Lakes Trophy Ranch.
We don't have plantations here.
Oh, that's right. We're thinking about the South. Yeah. Well, the Trophy Ranch, they have a lot. It's a majority selections of whitetail, and Willie has a specific one he was going after. We've seen trail cameras of it, and hopefully tonight be successful. So maybe I have a possible way that I can hunt. If not, just having fun and watching Willie having fun, and to hopefully for him to get his deer. I think that's the best thing for me, you know, making sure that he gets his deer.
Well, you got to get back, I guess, right? You got, your son is in sports.
Correct. My son has a soccer tournament this weekend, so.
So you know what? I guess we're supposed to put our seatbelts on here. No, not really.
No.
Of course, when you're with me, even if we're not moving, we should probably have our seatbelts on.
And helmets in the car.
So anyway, with this morning's hunt, how is it that you guys go sit in the stand with all the cameras and you're all set, and I'm sitting in a stand and nobody's with me and I see all the deer?
Well, looking at last night hunt, I believe you planned this, because last night hunt, we have a lot of deer, but
I scared them all away.
You scared them all away. So this morning, you must have did the same thing.
No, they all came to me this morning, so it couldn't have been me that scared them away.
I don't know what happened right there. We were sent free. I believe he had something planted. He was cutting the deer off from us.
You watch tonight, you're going to go to the stand, and it'll all be at a different stand again.
Probably so. Maybe Big E need to be the cameraman. You might be the lucky man and bring it in, and I can just go and sit at another stand.
You know, we have to get your son up here. Maybe we can get him on a big whitetail.
Maybe a few more years. I think that we should wait for him a few more years until he gets a little bit older.
You could ruin a kid on a place like this.
Absolutely.
Get him up here, they shoot something too big, and then all of a sudden their expectations are blowing, and then
you are ruining any typical Alabama hunter up here. We don't have anything this size, the caliber. Even their smallest deers are Boone and Crockett deer, which is 150 inch. That's a massive deer in Alabama.
You know, one of the other things I like about hunting on a ranch with folks is that there are no predator problems. I mean, they have predators in here, but they don't have the predator problems that we face outside of the ranches. And that brings us back to the wolves. You know, you and I are planning on going on some bear wolf hunts out west, because we can hunt wolves in Montana, Idaho, up in Alaska. But the wolves that they planted here in Wisconsin, they stalk these wolves, you know.
They stalk them?
They stalked them, yeah.
Well, it's just like, sounds like, just like how Alabama, when they were, they were first introduced to coyotes in the early 70s, late 60s, and now they took over. And because of the habitat, they are conquering our woods, because they're killing, out of 10 fawns, they're killing at least 8. But yeah. I could see up here having coyotes up here, because you have the terrain that you could hunt them. We have more underbrush. I mean, here's more open, you know, where you could probably easy be successful to kill a coyote. But down the south, your coyote luck is very limited, because they hide all over the place.
Yeah, you guys have a lot of that entangled thorn brush and all that. I mean, it's hard to get around. Sometimes I wonder how the deer get around down there. And so I suppose the coyotes, it's easy for them to ambush on the trails. But what they did here is, you know, 10 years ago or so, maybe longer, they decided that it would be a good idea to bring in the gray wolf or timber wolf or whatever the heck they brought in here, and they released these wolves. And they all ran around with radio collars on them for a long time, and then they got the population up, and then they started a season on them. And the same wolves are here. They're in Minnesota and I believe Michigan. And they had the season on them. We could hunt 50 to 75 a year or whatever it was. And they estimated that there's about 260 to 275 of these things running around the state, which if the DNR estimates that there's that many, there's probably twice as many. And as of last year, they were put on the endangered list because the wolf lovers, you know how those tree huggers and those wolf lovers are, they went crying to the federal judge and got her, it's a female federal judge that they got to, she listed them as endangered species and we can no longer hunt them, period. So now, here's this problem that we had, that we wouldn't have had, but the DNR decided, hey, this would be a great idea, let's put wolves in Wisconsin, so they put them in. A species that we didn't have here, and now we can't hunt them, and all they're going to do is reproduce, and we are having more and more cattle attacks, more and more deer disappearing, and now we might even have, according to the latest news, a guy that got attacked, a human attack, or a human encounter of some sort, that happened just this last week with them.
Let's do the math. What year did they introduce wolves here?
I don't remember what. I'm going to say roughly 10, 15 years ago. But then we started hunting them.
But so, you're saying that in average year you'll have 55 to 75 wolves. I mean, wolf tags to hunt.
Right.
Now, when you're killing the wolf, do you have to report to DNR how many wolves that was killed, or if you got a tag, and once they kill a wolf, is it reported?
Yes, they have to report it, yep.
So, and I assume that DNR keeps a bookkeeping of how many wolves being killed, but if you look at it, if they release 2,000 in the wild, or 285 in the wild, and each female wolf have pups, you're looking at a possibility at least 6 to 8 pups. What is it, yearly or twice a year?
Yeah.
the breeding cycle of wolves.
Yeah, I don't even know if they do it twice a year, but let's say they only do it once, so 6 to 8 pups, and let's say that half of the wolves that are out there, if they say there's 275 of them out there right now, let's say half of them are females, and they're having 6 to 8 pups apiece. Let's say only half of them live, so 3. So you're looking at this year alone, there'd be, what, roughly 100. Let's say 100 females, so they're going to have 300 pups that live.
Correct. And if you think about it, the only prey wolves have
would be another wolf, I think.
Would be another wolf or a human.
Mm-hmm.
So I can't see where the population is correct. Because a wolf is on top of he's one of the top predators in the wolf, in the wild beside a bear.
Yep. Hold on a second. We got to take a break. We'll be right back.
This segment of Biggie Outdoors is brought to you by Snap Fitness of Wausau. It's time to get in shape, and Snap Fitness is the right place to do it. With 2 locations in Weston and Wausau, you're never far from a Snap Fitness. Open 24/7 for members with clean and well-maintained equipment. Check out their new location across from Fleet Farm on Wausau's north side with all new machines and equipment. Sign up for some classes or training. Pick up the supplements you need and take advantage of the monthly deals and sign-up specials they have going on now. The staff at Snap Fitness is waiting for you to assist you in any way they can. So head on down to Snap Fitness today and get signed up.
We're back here with some more Biggie Outdoor Radio, and we were just discussing the math around wolves. So, you know, I guess, you know, let's say when they started that they only planted, I believe when they stocked them, they probably only planted, you know, like 5 breeding pairs or maybe 10 breeding pairs. So that's how it started to multiply. And however they multiplied or whatever would have naturally hunted them off and killed them, you know, I don't know. I don't know what they're saying, but you know, even if the females only had 2 pups that survived, you still, the math, just to get it to 200 or to 250 to where they're at right now. So it did take this long, but now the fact is that the wolf population's at 250, and they're saying that every year that killing 50 to 75 of these things with the tags was keeping the population at bay. There's no way that that was keeping up with the amount of pups that were being born. And now we're not hunting them at all. We're done.
Well, even if you're killing 50 to 75 and you only have 285 in the whole state of Wisconsin, did they drop them off in a high fence for you to kill all that many? There's no way that it's adding up where you dropping, you know.
That would still only keep up with only having 1 pup.
But there's no way, your success rate, just they claim that they're minimum.
Well, we're getting
minimum.
Them. We're getting them. Because what they do is they issue all the tags, and they would say they would keep each zone open until people killed enough wolves in that zone. And they'd say, well, let's say there's 25 wolf tags in this zone or 25 in that zone. And when each zone would fill up, they would close it down. They'd say, okay, that zone's closed. And these wolf hunters would go out and they would get them.
Well, it proves already that there's way more than 285 wolves. If you think about the square mileage
yep.
of Wisconsin.
Yep, I agree.
It's no, I mean, in each zone is getting their limit. There's more wolves than you can count. Because it's, I mean, that hunter, he's got to be at, he's going to be very lucky, or he's got tags on him, or they have some kind of tracking device to find him.
That's right. So the fact that they're able to kill him that fast, and they kill these things. Some of these wolves are actually killed within the first weekend. These zones close, some of them, or the first week. So that's how fast they're able to kill them.
There's a lot of wolves then.
Yeah. And now, like I said, and now, so I don't believe that they were even doing a good job of keeping up with the population. And now, like I said, they closed it down. So now we are really in trouble because you do the math, and that's what gets me is that you've got the DNR, and now we're talking about game wardens. We had a conversation about game wardens earlier, anyhow, but you're dealing with people that are supposed to have gone to school for this stuff. And they're supposed to be educated. And here we are sitting here talking. And we can do the math on how many animals can be born. We see it all the time. And we're even being generous by saying, let's say half of them are killed or eaten by their own families or whatever, which is probably not happening. And the math just multiplies these things way faster than what they're giving it credit for. You know, they're saying, oh, well, you know, we killed enough last year that they're pretty much saying that where the population was last year and the hunt happened and everything, that the population only went up by 10.
Well, how's DNR doing their studies? Are they flying in air, putting traps out, darting these wolves to see the population? I mean, that's the whole thing we got to look at if they're doing that.
I think they go by sightings. There are some that have radio collars on still, but they don't fly, and there's no way that they can really tell anymore. They just go by guesstimations. They think they know where all the packs are too yet, and that's the other thing.
Nothing against the game wardens, because I got a lot of game warden friends down in the South, but
we won't tell anybody.
As you know, there's a lot of people like in my job too to just claim that, you know, they working, but really and truthfully they're not working. So you got to have a correct amount of sightings, because somebody can go out there and say that, oh, I patrol this area, and has got the mileage on their vehicles but didn't get out the vehicle. I mean, yeah. You have to do more and more studies. And I'm thinking, is this DNR, you already know how it is, their funding is very limited.
Yeah.
So they're doing a lot of things on their own. So I think that the state need to put more money into DNR to more research to see if this isn't true. I mean, just think about it. If you look at it, how many game warden are assigned to per zone? You're talking about possibly one game warden per zone that's thousands and thousands of acres.
Yeah.
There's no way that game warden would have an accurate count.
No. And, you know, on the other hand, I think when they did this, that some of the wolf introduction was also put in here to fight the CWD. Because they were so worried about CWD in the state of Wisconsin or whatever, I don't know. But it definitely has taken an impact on our deer. Because outside of these ranches that we're on, there's no deer. Just like the owner of Three Lakes Trophy Ranch here, we went out, he's got land outside. We went out there just to sight in the guns, and we asked him about hunting out in the open. It's beautiful country out there. And what did he tell us? There's no deer out here.
Just bears and wolves.
That's what he said. The only thing you're going to see out here is bears and wolves. There's no deer. So, you know, you'd think that there would be deer, especially around a place like this where he's got breeding pens right here and things like that. You'd think there'd be deer. He said there's nothing. No tracks, nothing. No deer. And that's a pretty sad deal.
What's going to happen is those wolves are going to find themselves in the communities and start attacking more civilians.
Well, you know, that is what is already happening here. I've got written down that so far they're talking about all the cattle and stuff. The cattle attacks are up. But even dogs, this year, they're saying that our dog attacks are up to 26 this year over 22 from last year.
That's only reported. There's a lot of ones that never report, so that's just only reported.
Actually, I'm sorry. There's 29. Yeah, you're right. Reported. And of the 29, 23 of those are hunting dogs. These are guys that are out bear hunting and stuff, and their hunting dogs have been attacked and eaten and killed by wolves. Six of them were pets, and one of them was a rescue dog.
Sounds like you have a problem.
Yeah. So there are already, and these pets and the rescue dog were all snatched out of the backyards. They were all, the wolves came in and snatched them out of backyards. So they're coming in, and eventually they're going to be sneaking into the suburbs more and more. And if people think coyotes were a problem in a suburb, wait till you start having wolves sneaking into the suburbs. Because when they start coming in for lunch, they're going to get more than just dogs and cats. They're going to start going after kids, I think.
A wolf, yeah, and if you think about a wolf, over 100-something-pound wolf, coyotes
are nothing.
They're small.
Yeah, yeah. So that is kind of interesting. And then used to be, like, if the wolves were attacking farmers' cows, they could use lethal means of control. They could say, oh, we're going to give you a tag to kill kill the wolves. Same thing with this guy here. He's got this, you know, whitetail. He makes his living off of this. Now, because they've been put on the endangered list, they can't do that anymore. Now they tell them they got to put up electric fences, and they got to, you know, now for a high fence operation, electrical work, because you can put electric at the bottom and then halfway up and then all the way at the top, and things aren't going to crawl over. But for a cattle fence, how the heck is electric going to work? The wolf will find its way through that. But they're trying to say that electric fences around cattle farms is going to keep these wolves out, keep them from eating.
Well, that's another thing. And who's going to fit this bill? Is the government going to fit this bill that's for them to get electric fence?
Yep, the taxpayers pay for it. We also have to pay for the animals that the wolves eat. And this year, we're already up to 41 cattle killed this year. Last year, we had a total of 28. Our record kill was in 2011, which was right before we started hunting. So we started hunting wolves in 2012. In 2011, our wolf kill was at 106 cattle. and that costed us taxpayers $300,000. And cattle prices were low then. So now cattle prices are up. We only have 41 killed, but it's double almost of last year, and think what it's going to be next year. And cattle prices are way up now. So we're looking at, pretty soon we're going to be looking at $1 million a year in cattle prices and stuff that we're paying because the wolves are eating them.
And if you do the math, us American citizens have to pay for our taxpayer dollars, have to pay for the farmers' fences.
Yep.
How much is an average tag?
Yeah.
How much is an average tag for a wolf?
Wolf tag? I am not sure. We'll have to look it up. Probably a couple hundred. I mean, imagine maybe $50. Hey, welcome back to some more Biggie Outdoor Radio, and we're here in our mobile studio with Ernest Williams, one of our pro staffers. He's filling in for Brandon this week while Brandon's off. You don't suppose he's doing any fishing off the back of that cruise ship, do you?
Knowing Brandon, he's probably skinny dipping.
That's a sight I don't want to even picture in my head, you know. That big old red bearded redneck.
Sperm whales, you know how white they are, that's how.
Because, yeah, he's got no tan, that's for sure. Holy smokes, I'm telling you. He'd be jiving in and out of the waves behind the boat back there. Well, you know, we were talking about the wolves, and it was, they were made endangered or put on the endangered list by a federal judge, a female liberal federal judge. By the way, on this radio show, we're not afraid to attack liberals. We do that quite often. Probably got that. See that?
I see that.
And that same judge, her name is Barbara something or another, 7th District Court judge. She just passed a really, this is a good law. The Native Americans, now nothing against the Native Americans, the Indian, but this whole treaty thing and this whole we owe you thing, it's been pushed for a long ways. I mean, you know what? The Indian Wars, General Custer, all that stuff, that was a long time ago. They just keep pushing it. Now, they just got approved to hunt at night. Now, we can't hunt at night. None of us, none of the rest of the United States citizens. It doesn't matter whether you're black, white, yellow. It doesn't matter. You cannot hunt at night. Can't hunt with a spotlight. But the Indians just got approved that they can hunt at night in the state of Wisconsin, and they don't have to stay on the reservation land. They can go anywhere where there's public land.
Okay, I'm a person of color. And my answer was in slavery. And I understand we need to move forward. And I've always moved forward. I never looked in the past, but this is 2015, about 2016, and the money that's going to these tribal institutions, it's phenomenal. And then half the time, a local law enforcement officer can't enforce laws there because they have their own, they're a special group of people.
Yeah, you know what? As you know, that if something goes on a reservation, we have to call federal law enforcement because state law enforcement can't even go on there.
Correct, which is absolutely crazy.
It's insane, yeah.
I've read about the crime rate that happens on Indian reservations, and for us to give Indians, I mean, they're saying that Indians are better hunters than the non-Indian people there is that living in the United States?
Mm-hmm.
Are they saying they're better hunters than us?
I don't know, but they don't allow us to hunt at night, which, because it's unsafe, and heck, I agree with that. I think it is. I mean, you're out there driving around with spotlights, shooting at night. That is what they're telling them. Now, get this. This is what the requirements are for them. They have to take a test to prove that their skills of hunting at night are good. They have to use a spotlight, and they have to shoot into a backstop. Now, what in the world kind of a backstop are they going to be shooting into when they're poaching deer at night? Basically, they just gave them a license to poach on all the grounds that the rest of the citizens of Wisconsin and out-of-staters that pay to come and hunt here want to come, and these out-of-state people come and pay, $180 for a license to come and hunt here. But now, when they get here to come and hunt these public hunting grounds, there aren't going to be any deer there because the Native Americans were able to drive around and hunt all the big bucks off of there at night. They were able to legally poach them. Same judge that put the wolf on the endangered list for us.
That's crazy because, once again, I mean,
we're on the radio and people can't see the expression on your face right now. That's the...
that's crazy because, once again, it's race and religion. I mean, that's all I can think of was causing the judge to, unless they found something that this is what, you know, like Native Americans, they smoke peyote, you know, so yeah. they got that pass. So maybe that's to bring her closer to their Indian heritage of hunting at night, because I guess they used to hunt at night back in before.
Okay, you know what? Let's go. So did we, Ernie. You go back far enough down our lines. Okay, you said you're a person of color. Okay, we know what? We came from somewhere, whether you're black or you're white, we all came from somewhere. At one point, we were all living in huts or caves or somewhere, and we all hunted with spears and sticks, and we all hunted to survive. It doesn't matter whether you're Native American or Native African or Native European. Somehow, through time, we evolved. And we... you know, came from places where we all grew up hunting, or we all, if you trace our origin back, we're really no different. You're no different, I'm no different than those Native Americans.
Oh, absolutely. I would just like to see the language, the order that was issued by the judge, and read it and see why the Native Americans has been given approval to hunt. Now, could they hunt wolves or no?
You know what? That would be an interesting thing to find out if they can actually, because they can actually kill an eagle. Native Americans, because I don't know if they can kill them or not, but they can have the eagle feathers, and that's all part of their ritual. They can use things. They can have things that we can't.
I can see maybe that because it's part of their ritual of the feathers, but shooting at night, I can't see the ritual. I think they're. Look at paintings or, you know, TV shows or whatever. Native Americans hunted more than just this night. They hunted in the daytime. So I got to read the language and see why they're allowed to shoot at night and average citizen can't.
If they're going back to the days of old, they didn't use spotlights. They used spears and bows and arrows. So if they want to do it that way, then if you want to hunt at night, use spears and bows and arrows, I guess, you know.
So this could bring them back to their culture by hunting at night?
I don't know. Because you don't know about it, I'm going to tell you another thing that they can do. We have a lot of really nice walleye in Wisconsin. It's good eating fish. You ever eaten walleye?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Great eating fish.
When a walleye run here in the state, up north, go talk to some of these fishing guides and the people around here, and they'll tell you that they can't really help you get on a big walleye. They can catch you some average-sized ones and things like that. Because the big walleye are all gone because the Native Americans can net these things up and then they spear them. So they spear all the big ones. Every year they have a time where they're allowed to corral them into nets and spear them. And they spear thousands and thousands and thousands of them. And they don't eat them all. They just, you know, they just do it because it's part of their tradition.
Well, maybe I need to move to Wisconsin and we'll go down to my black heritage and see what I'm lacking.
Somewhere and you might be Indian.
Right. And go to the judge and say that, you know, we need special stuff, you know. Because, you know, we used to hunt lions and all that stuff in Africa, my ancestors. So maybe the government need to let some lions loose in the wilderness and let us black people hunt them so I can feel closer to my culture.
Yeah, there we go. It's about that ridiculous. Trust me that in one of our coming up segments, we'll be talking about lions here yet before it's over, but yeah.
Oh, all right.
Can you see, that's what I mean. It's just this whole way that it's whatever these liberals are on and wherever they're headed with things, it's like I sometimes think that they push to divide us even further. with some of the things that they do. It's like, if there's going to be a law, it's a law, period. It's for everybody. Either you can on at night or you can't on at night. Either you can spear fish or you can't spear fish.
Well, in the state of Alabama, I can tell you right now, lottery of gambling machines, illegal. But on the Indian reservations, we have them.
Same here.
And that, I just don't understand that. How can because it's on Indian reservation, they can break the law. You're saying that if you have Indian reservation, you can go and break the law anytime you want to. You can have stuff that's not, you know, welcoming, you know, in the rest of the part of the world who, because it's against the people's religion or whatever beliefs about gambling. But when you go to, sounds like you can do anything when you want when you go into these Indian reservations. It's just like going to Nevada, going to the Bunny Ranch. Yeah.
That's another thing, yeah. I mean, and that's got nothing to do with the Native Americans. Now you're looking at, right, the state of Nevada, prostitution's legal.
Correct.
I think that that should be gotten rid of, too. All that. Yeah, we're running low on time. But, you know, either they should make prostitution legal all over, which we could talk about, or they should just get rid of it.
Correct.
You know. I'm sure that we'd have a lot of people calling in, talking to us about...
Maybe the tree huggers need to call in about these prostitutes. What do they think about that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We'll let the Native Americans have night hunting and we get prostitutes.
And us people of color get lions.
And you get lions, right. We're going to put lions up for you.
Because I feel like I have to, you know, get closer to my culture.
Yeah, we have to put some lions in. I think we better take a break on that note.
Yes.
Okay, we'll be right back with some more Biggie Outdoor Radio.